Dear students, last time we have studied about the states of matter and we have read that there are three states of matter, that is solid, liquid and gases, and then in that we have studied various properties of solid, liquid and gases. Now question arises that can a substance can exist in all the three states? Question is, can a substance can exist in all the three states? Answer is yes, it is possible. Now, do you know the example? Of course you do know. You know the example. What is the example? The example is that of water. Water is in the liquid state. You all know, water can flow. It changes its shape when it is put in the different containers. So it is a liquid. Then we know ice. Ice is a solid. And we also know the steam part of vapors. Steam or vapors. Vapors of water. That is a gaseous part. So, one substance, water, which you have a chemical formula H2O. You have to remember it. I don't know whether you know it or not. But this is the formula of the water. H2O. You can ask, what is SF? H is hydrogen. What is O? O is oxygen. So, formula of water is H2O. Okay. Now, water can exist in all the three states. Now, question arises, how it is possible? At one time, it is existing as a solid. In another time, it is existing as vapors. So, why it is so? Then, the answer is that, number one, it is the temperature which matters. Temperature. If we increase the temperature, now for increase, I put an arrow just like this. Okay, when we increase the temperature, then what happens is, energy is supplied to particles. Energy is supplied to the particles. Now, in the previous chapter, what I have told you, that the particles are two having a force of attraction between them. There is a force of attraction between the particles. Now, in case of solids, what happens is that the forces of attraction are too large. They are so large that they do not let the other particle move away from each other. They just oscillate at their position, just like this. So, what happens is that they only oscillate at their positions, they do not move away in case of solids. But in case of gases, what is there? Gases, the particles are far apart. So, once the particles are far apart, it means that there are very less forces of attraction between them. And once the forces of attraction are less, it means that they can move away. Nobody bothers about the other because the force of attraction is less. Okay, so when we start heating a solid, then what we are doing? We are providing them the energy. What we are doing? We are providing them the energy. That is, and once energy is provided to them, it means the forces of attraction between, they start moving here and there, because once somebody gets the energy, then it becomes full of energy, and energy means motion. Energy means motion. So motion is provided to the particles. And once the motion is provided to the particles, it means that they want to move away from each other. So what to do? They try to grow these forces of attraction among the particles. And if the energy is supplied in such an amount that it can break down all the forces of attraction, then what happens is, these particles start moving away from each other and they change their state, because if the particles are strongly bound, then it is a solid. If the particles are far apart, then it is a gas. So for the same element, if the forces of attraction are very very large, then it becomes solid, and if it is very very less, then it becomes a gas. So this is what happens is that when we increase the temperature, increase in temperature means energy supplied to the particles, so it breaks the forces of attraction of particles. So what happens is, due to it, particles move away from each other and it leads to the change in state. That is, if it is solid, then by supplying the temperature, it changes into the liquid, and if it's liquid, then by supplying the temperature, it changes into the gas. Okay, so you have to understand it very very carefully what I'm telling you, that one substance can exist in all the three states. It is the force of attraction with which the particles are bound to each other that determines whether a substance is a solid, liquid or gas. If the force of attraction between the particle is maximum, then it is solid. If it is minimum, then it is gas. When we supply a temperature or a heat, then what we are supplying? We are increasing the energy of the particles. If the energy increases, then the force of attraction between the particles that start breaking down. If the force of attraction break down, then the particles move from each other, which leads to the change in the state. That is, if solid changes into the liquid and liquid changes into the gas. Sometimes it also happens that the solid directly changes into the gaseous state, and that is called as sublimation. But it is that called as sublimation. So what is sublimation? Sublimation is the process in which solid directly changes into the gaseous state without undergoing into the liquid state. वो liquid state में नहीं जाते हैं. What they do? They changes directly from the solid to the gaseous state. So now with it, there are few terms which are associated. First term is melting point. First term is melting point. Now you all know what do you mean by melting? You know melting. You must have seen that if you put the ice in the room temperature, then slowly it changes into the water. This process is called as melting. Even when you start heating the plastic, then slowly it changes into the liquid part. That is called as melting. Now question is, what is this melting point? Then the answer is, the temperature at which a solid changes into a liquid at its atmospheric pressure is called as melting point. So I will write down the definitions which are important related to this topic just now. So students, the definition of the melting point will be the temperature at which the solid changes into the liquid at the atmospheric pressure is called as melting point. As you know that the melting point of ice is 100 degrees. That is the melting point of ice. So that is a fixed temperature, and that temperature is called as its melting point. Now one thing that you have to keep in your mind, that melting point is directly proportional to the forces of attraction between the particles. What does it mean? It means that if the force of attraction between the particle is high, then the melting point will be high. And if the forces of attraction between the particles of a substance is less, then its melting point will also be less. Last time I have told you what is the symbol called as. The symbol is called as directly proportional, direct impact. If it is high, then it will be high. If it is low, then it is low. Okay. So melting point is indication of the forces of attraction between the particles. Now, one more thing that you have to keep in mind, process of melting is also called as fusion. That is, melting is also called as fusion. Now, suppose what happens is that I do have a container here. I have put down ice here. Okay. Then I start heating it. There is a diagram. Here it is the ice. I start heating it. Now, what happens is that as soon as it reaches 0 degree Celsius, that is at 0 degree Celsius, what will happen? It will start melting. It will start melting. It will start melting. Okay. So, now, what happens is that I keep on heating and I keep on noting down the temperature, whether the temperature is getting increased or not. Now, whenever I increase the, when I heating something, then the temperature should rise. Okay. But when the ice is getting heated up, what I will see? I will see that the temperature will not rise. It will remain zero until all the ice gets changed into the water. The temperature will remain zero. Are you getting my point? What I am saying? I am saying that once I start heating it, then until all the ice is changed into the water, the temperature of this container will not increase. Now the question should come in your mind that where is this heat going on? If we are heating it, then the temperature should rise. But why the temperature is not getting raised? The answer is that this heat is used up in breaking the forces of attraction between the particles of ice. So whatsoever the heat I explain, that heat is getting used up in breaking down the forces of attraction between the ice particles, water particles in case of ice. So whatsoever the heat I explain that is used up in breaking the forces of attraction, that's why the temperature of this container do not get rise up until all the ice get converted into the water. Same thing happens with every substance. Once it reaches the melting point, then the temperatures of the container in which that melting occurs, that will not increase until all that substance get melted up. Now, this heat is called as heat of fusion, latent heat of fusion. Latent heat of fusion. Here in case of melting, it is called as latent heat of fusion. Okay, so now, the definition of latent heat of fusion, it is the amount of heat required to convert 1 kilogram of a solid into the liquid at atmospheric pressure at its melting point. Again, what it is? The amount of heat required to convert 1 kilogram of solid into liquid. 1 kilogram of solid into liquid. When? At atmospheric pressure. When? At its melting point. Okay. So, you can just break down this in 3 parts. Number 1, the amount of heat required to convert 1 kilogram of a solid into liquid. 1 part. At its atmospheric pressure, second part. At its melting point, third part is called as latent heat of fusion. Now remember that out of ice and water, which has a more cooling effect? Question comes to you that out of ice and water, which has more cooling effect? Ice or water? The answer is ice. Why it is not water? Because in converting from ice to water, some heat is absorbed. and it is therefore it do have a lesser heat, and lesser is the heat, more is the cooling effect. Lesser is the heat, more is the cooling effect. So ice do have a more cooling effect than that of water. Similarly, we can define the latent heat of vaporization. Vaporization, converting of liquid into the vapors at its boiling point. Just like the melting point, it is boiling point. What is boiling point? The temperature at which a liquid changes into its, what is it? Liquid changes into its vapors at the atmospheric pressure is called as boiling point. Very, very easy. If you remember the definition, then you can remember that also. The temperature at which liquid changes into the vapors at the atmospheric pressure is called as boiling point. Again, latent heat of vaporization, the amount of heat required to convert 1 kilogram of a liquid into the vapors at atmospheric pressure at its boiling point is called as latent heat of vaporization. Again, the question comes that if both boiling water and steam are at 100 degrees Celsius, then which will create more sphere worms? Which will create more sphere worms? Then the answer will be steam, because it do have more heat, which is called as latent heat of vaporization, than that of liquid water. I hope that you must have understood all these topics. I will give you the questions later on, and you will do those questions in your homework. Thank you.